I will try to, this talk will be actually purely theoretical, so I will, it is mostly based on rigorous mathematical theorems. I will try to make it simple, I will limit technical details, but basically the, I mean, everything that that is in it is something which is by now understood theoretically. There will be some slight overlap with the talk of Matos Salgarsky that he did on Tuesday, but well, not very big, I guess. So before I come to more technical stuff, I would just like to give some general ideas. So what are actually the main points? In plain words, what do I want to convey? So the first point is actually is that it seems that one can identify something like different approximation phases in the case of neural networks, deep neural networks. So it is essential here that the network is deep. So there is some analogy with the physical phases. So you know that, for example, we can have water which can be in the liquid state or in the solid state. At the same time, it can have different values of various parameters like temperature, pressure, and so on. But be in the same state, in the same phase, thermodynamic phase. On the other hand, at some point, there might be a very abrupt transition to a state with quite quite qualitatively different properties. So there is something like that which seems to also be possible in deep neural networks. So I will explain in which sense. So there should be, I should say, some caveats actually, obviously, about that. Basically, the main point is that you can different phases depend on how we define the optimal optimal state of the network in some sense. So depending on the definition, the this leads actually to quite different structures eventually. The second point is a kind of elaboration of the first one. So more specifically, one can observe that if there is some opportunity to use high precision arithmetic, if the network is the underlying, for example, implementation of the arithmetic is has high precision, then this can be used at least potentially and, well, to limited extent to reduce the complexity of the network, to reduce the complexity of the architecture. I will also kind of quantify this claim, what exactly this means. The third point is that, which I also kind of find interesting, is that I will basically speak about solving some smooth problems. So it will be about fitting approximation of smooth functions, but it seems that the optimal solutions of these problems actually require the structure to the computation to be in some sense highly discontinuous, to be this is, there is some kind of coding theory flavor in the constructions that I will show. So it's kind of quite unlike what can be expected if we just think of the problem as a smooth problem. Okay, now so here is the plan. So what precisely I will discuss. So I will start with some very basic abstract approximation theory. So this actually the stuff that I'm discussing is most naturally formulated in terms of approximation theory, and there are some classical very general results which kind of set the stage for everything. After that, I will describe the relevance of this for neural networks, particularly the ReLU networks, and what can be viewed as a classical phase, so to say, of this, of the approximation fitting. Then I will make a digression. I would like to briefly discuss the Kolmogorov superposition theorem, just to explain that the this approximation picture can be entirely different from what we may see in this classical setting, so to say. And then I will return to the ReLU networks and describe what is actually what can be viewed as a deep discontinuous phase. And finally, also briefly discuss some possible extensions of this topic. Okay, so first of all, the abstract approximation theory. So, I mean, this talk will only be concerned with this basic setting. So we have some function f from a functional family capital F, and we want to construct an approximation or model f hat such that the difference between the norm of the difference between these two functions is small. Okay, so this is the standard problem of the approximation theory. So I will not actually, obviously, deep learning is much more than just that. So it's about optimization, generalization, finite sampling phenomena, and so on. I will not discuss it in this talk. It will be purely about this approximation problem. And the solutions that I will describe also are not found by numerical optimization, but rather just described explicitly. Now, the central question in this area is the complexity accuracy relation. So we are interested to find the optimal dependence between the accuracy of the approximation and the complexity of and its complexity. Okay, so to have the minimal complexity, basically. Okay, so I will mostly consider functional spaces which are just Sobolev balls. So this is actually mathematically one of the simplest and convenient abstraction, so to say. So what is a Sobolev ball? In simple terms, this is just the set of smooth functions on, well, I will consider basically functions on the unit cube in some dimension. And this Sobolev ball is just the set of those functions that have derivatives up to some order, fixed order R, and they are all bounded by one in absolute value. So that's a very simple object. So there is actually, there are some more general definitions of Sobolev spaces which involve some LP, more complex LP norms and so on, but actually it's not really important. So what is important is that we have functions on the space of a particular dimensionality. This is D, I will denote it by D. And second, that these functions have a particular smoothness, so I will denote it by R. Okay, so there are two parameters which characterize the Sobolev ball. There is also a radius, the radius of this ball, but I will just take it to be equal to one. Okay, so the derivatives, the existing derivatives are supposed to be bounded by one. Okay, so we have this, so that's basic, that's a very simple thing, essentially. There is one interesting, another interesting quantity associated with Sobolev balls. It's actually the, something that can be called the complexity. So this is what, this is the ratio of D dimensionality to R. So why is it actually natural to call it complexity? Well, obviously, if D is large, the dimension is large, then the set is more complex, right? The function is more complex. So the numerator is larger, then the complexity should also be larger. On the other hand, if R is larger, it means that the functions are smoother, right? If they are smoother, it means that they are sort of more constrained. So there is less flexibility in them, which means that the complexity should actually be smaller. Okay, so that's why it is natural to speak about complexity as this ratio. And very interestingly, this exactly this ratio actually appears in many formulas, which which involve Sobolev balls and various kind of relations about Sobolev balls. Okay, the first general result, general theory that I just want to briefly mention, briefly explain, is the information theory. So information, so I will always denote by epsilon the approximation accuracy. And also I will always mean it in the sense of the, well, L infinity norm, the usual uniform norm. So the maximum difference, okay? Now, there is a general definition of epsilon entropy of a set in a metric space. It is just given by the logarithm of the so-called covering number. So covering number is the smallest number of epsilon balls which cover the set F, okay? So essentially this epsilon entropy kind of determines the minimal model expressiveness that we need in order to reach the uniform accuracy. So suppose that we can just generate a finite number of models that we use to kind of approximate the elements of this from this set F. So this is in our case this will be just the Sobolev ball. So if we have a finite number of models and they all provide approximation, they are supposed to provide epsilon approximation for each point in the set, it means that the numbers cannot be less than the covering number, right? So this means that this gives us this entropy, epsilon entropy of a set gives us the lower bound for the expressiveness that must be somehow implemented in the model. Okay. And the important theorem for us is the theorem of, well, Kolmogorov essentially, later maybe also refined slightly in the paper of Kolmogorov-Tikhomirov, which tells us the epsilon entropy of the Sobolev balls. Okay? And the formula is actually very very simple. So it is asymptotically, it behaves like epsilon raised to the power minus complexity of the Sobolev ball. So as promised, so it features this ratio. So I must say that this only this is the asymptotic in the limit of epsilon going to zero. So it means that we fix the set. So I'm not discussing the issue of what happens if we change the smoothness, if we change dimension, and so on. This is actually quite difficult and subtle. Not much progress here. This asymptotic is only concerns the limit of epsilon going to zero. Okay. So what is the pragmatic meaning of this theorem? It tells us that essentially the model, if the model provides accuracy epsilon, then it must contain at least this number of bits of information, roughly epsilon raised to the power minus complexity. Okay, so we cannot actually achieve small approximation uniformly for all functions from of given smoothness defined on the given cube if we do not somehow implement, realize in this model roughly this amount of information. Okay. I will not, of course, I will not prove this theorem, but I just want to give some illustration. So why it is actually quite reasonable. So why it kind of... So let's just take the simplest case when the dimension is one and the smoothness is also one. It's just the space of Lipschitz functions, functions on the interval which have bounded value and bounded derivative. Okay, so we have suppose that we have this true function which is the blue line, and we want to construct approximation. So let's just take as the approximation a simple piecewise linear curve which can have slope 1 or minus 1. So let's just divide the segment into n equal parts and consider the as the approximation, consider the best the optimally fitting curve which has slopes minus 1 or plus 1. Obviously, the number of such approximations is roughly 2 to the power n. Well, not exactly, because there is some additional degree of freedom associated with the boundary value, for example, but roughly the main contribution to the asymptotic is 2 to the power n. On the other hand, the accuracy is roughly 1 over n. Now, if we look at the definition of the entropy, we see that it is actually roughly, it can be estimated as the by the logarithm of 2 to the power n, which is roughly speaking n, and equal to epsilon 1 over epsilon, right? So this is exactly what is prescribed by this theorem. Now, if we thinking about more general situations, so if we have larger dimension, larger smoothness, well, in how can we extend this? So in the case of dimension, obviously we can kind of consider grid, uniform grid, and the generalization is more or less natural. In the case of smoothness, one should actually replace, one should use a Taylor expansion approximation locally instead of just taking these pieces with slope plus 1 or minus 1. But, well, this is the, in the general case, this can also be, roughly speaking, proved in the same, in a similar manner, okay? Right. So, that was one general setting, that was one general theorem related to the information that, that must be in the model. The second general set of concepts, so to say, is related to so-called parametric approximation. So what does it mean? Suppose that our approximations are parametric. So before I haven't said anything about it, but now I want these approximations to be parametrized. So what does it mean? It means that we have some number of handles, some parameters that I well denote by W, such that the approximation is obtained by basically reconstructing the function using particular values of some of these parameters. So, well, in other words, we can speak of this as a set of two maps. So there is, first of all, a parameter assignment map. So given some function f that we want to approximate, we map this function to the particular vector in this w-dimensional space, okay? And then there is the opposite map in the opposite direction, which reconstructs the approximation from this Euclidean w-dimensional space. So if just to make it if you prefer, you can think of it as a neural network. So the parameter assignment map is just the map which assigns weights, the value of the weights to the network, and the reconstruction map is basically defined by the architecture. So if you have the architecture and if you have the values of the parameters, then you obviously obtain the approximation, which is just your network. Okay, so this is the general setup, and in this general setup, there is one important concept, which is called optimal uniform approximation or nonlinear width, and it is defined in this way. So what is it actually? So we consider this internal supremum is over all the functions of this ball. So we are interested in uniform approximation of functions from a Sobolev ball, which have, so to say, the same smoothness. And we consider, we try to find the optimal weight assignment, parameter assignment algorithm and the model reconstruction algorithm, so as to minimize this value. so as to minimize this uniform error. Okay, so this obviously this this value h w, this nonlinear width, is not connected to any particular implementation of the approximation. So this is actually a property of the set F. It is not a property of the model that we use to fit functions from F. So this infimum here is essentially taken over all possible models of fitting the function from F. Okay, and the remarkable result about this uniform approximation error is the theorem of DeVore, Howard, and Michele, which states that for Sobolev balls, we have the rate given asymptotically as the number of parameters times minus one over complexity of this ball. Okay, so again, a very nice simple relation also involving the complexity of the ball. So this again is the limit of the number of parameters going to infinity, actually. So it's similarly to the limit in the previous Kolmogorov information theory theorem. What is very interesting and important here is that this is this rate is obtained under assumption that the parameter assignment maps are continuous, and this is actually sometimes just people ask this question. So this is usually what this is not very typical of the actual neural networks. So when you find parameters in the neural network, typically by gradient descent or something like that, so you cannot actually guarantee, you cannot even keep track of whether this map is continuous or not. So typically there's no reason to expect that it is continuous, but for this particular theorem this is actually crucial. So it only holds under this assumption that the parameter assignment map is continuous. On the other hand, nothing, absolutely nothing, is assumed about the reconstruction map. Actually, it can be as irregular as you want. It can be non-differentiable at any point or something like that. But it doesn't have to be continuous, but the parameter assignment map might be continuous. Important special case of this is the linear weight assignment. This is actually the case of linear models, and all these results originally were obtained by Kolmogorov, I think, in the case of linear models. I will say more about it. So obviously, if the model is linear, then this parameter assignment is linear and continuous. So it applies in this case, but this is a far-reaching generalization. Okay, this is just an interesting fact that the proof of this theorem is based on the topological, one famous topological theorem, which is the so-called Borsuk-Ulam antipodality theorem. If you have an n-dimensional sphere and you continuously map it to the n-dimensional Euclidean space, you can find a point such that the antipodal point is mapped to the same point. So this is used in the proof of this lower bound. And obviously, this requires continuity. That's why continuity is important. Now, I want to give a simple example, just also to illustrate this. I mean, all these objects and kind of to make it more to clarify all the things that I have said. So let's take the usual Fourier series approximation. So this is one of the classical approximations. So we just have this standard expansion. And by the way, we can view it as some kind of precursor of the neural network. This is essentially a shallow neural network with the fixed hidden layer weights and the activation function, sine function. So the obviously the linear parameter assignment, the parameter assignment in this case is linear. It is given by the well-known formula, and the reconstruction map is also linear. So it's just given by the partial sums of this Fourier series expansion. Now, if we want the number of parameters to be equal to W, we actually need to restrict this sum to the values of this multi-index, which is roughly of the order of W to the power 1 over D. Then if we now look at, if you look at any textbook, you will see that the convergence, the Fourier series convergence rate is exactly given by the formula, which agrees with this theorem that I have just mentioned about the optimal approximation rate. Exactly because this is a general fact, so to say, it's not really related to a particular implementation. Also, let me just say a few words about the distribution of information. So, if we need to achieve accuracy epsilon, it's easy to check that we actually need the coefficients of the Fourier series to have precision of logarithm of 1 over epsilon bits, roughly. Why? Because we have roughly some a number of terms, which is power of epsilon. And then if we want to achieve accuracy epsilon, it's sufficient if we have, if we know coefficients C with accuracy, also a power of epsilon, that means that it must have precision of this number of bits. And the total information, what is the total information contained in this model? We have the number of parameters, which is again the same expression, epsilon minus to the power minus complexity. The information per parameter, as we see, is the logarithm of 1 over epsilon. And the total information is the product of these two values. And, well, the main contribution is this power, epsilon to the power minus dr. And this is, agrees up to this logarithmic factor with the prediction of this information theory general result. Okay, and similar conclusions actually hold for other classical linear methods, for example, splines, orthogonal polynomials, and so on, exactly because they are all subject to this general principle, because they are linear and you can apply basically this general reasoning. Now, I want to switch to neural networks because this is actually, in principle, this, as we know, this method is nonlinear, so what can we say about it? I think I should speed up a little. So, so in this case, as I already said, W just denotes the vector of network weights. The reconstruction map is explicitly given by the architecture of the network, and the weight assignment map is not actually defined. So this is, it can be either explicitly written somehow for some simple networks, or it can be found numerically. It is not actually contained a priori in this definition. And I will primarily focus on the ReLU networks with the ReLU activation function. So the question, obvious question that we immediately face is if we can achieve the classical rates of the classical approximation rates that we have just saw in the case of Fourier series and some other classical methods. Okay, so this is just, do we have the same result? Do they have the same rate? So the answer is yes. If the smoothness is equal to 1, this can be easily achieved using networks of constant depth. If the smoothness is greater than 1, then this can be achieved using ReLU networks of depth, which slowly grows, which grows logarithmically in epsilon. Epsilon is accuracy as usual. So in the case of r equal to 1, this is just Lipschitz functions. The approach that can be used here is just to kind of form special blocks in the network which create these bump functions, the spike functions, which can serve as a basis for a linear expansion. And then the whole network can be obtained by just kind of moving this bump around the around your cube and adding some weight coefficients. So if you do this, you can in principle approximate any function in this way. Okay, so this is obviously works and easy to implement. So these blocks are constant size. So the network is in principle, it's not just a two-layer network. It can have more than two layers, but it's the number of layers does not depend on the accuracy. So the weights, this is essentially a linear model. The weights are only used, variable weights are only used at the outputs of these blocks. So the all the other weights are actually fixed. Okay, there is the case of smoother functions if we have some smooth functions. The point here is that the question that naturally comes to mind is how can a non-smooth model exploit smoothness of the function. So the ReLU network is a piecewise linear function. It generates piecewise linear approximations, obviously. And we want, nevertheless, we want to somehow exploit the smoothness of the function f. So, but this can be actually done. So Matos-Tolgarsky actually explained this point in his lecture. I will only briefly mention it. So you can do some kind of reduction. First, you can, given a function f, you can apply a local Taylor expansion, reduce everything to polynomials, to approximating polynomials. Then you can use the polarization identity and reduce approximation of polynomials to approximation of the squaring function. And for the squaring function, you can give a simple construction which involves this sawtooth function, which is iterated 10th function. And then just you can take linear combination of this and obtain a very good approximation very fast. Okay, so that just works, and there's not much difficulties with this. So the conclusion is that we see that basically all the things that could be done for classical methods can also be done for neural networks, in particular ReLU networks, even if though they don't have smoothness built in. Now, I want to briefly discuss Kolmogorov superposition theorem, just because it offers a quite very different point of view, so to say. So the approximation, or well, actually the representation, which is found in this theorem, is in some sense entirely different from what we have just seen. And so it's just useful to keep this in mind to understand that there are different options. So this is the statement of this theorem. Actually, it's, well, in plain words, it can be stated in this way. So every multivariate continuous function or operation reduces to univariate continuous operations and sums. So if we have so precisely what does it say? If it claims that there is a finite number of some univariate continuous functions, phi ij, such that any multivariate continuous function can be represented using only these univariate functions and also some finite number of other univariate functions and the operation of sum, of taking the sum. Okay, so we have this remarkable formula. The constants d here is just the dimension, so the sum is finite and it does not grow. And also one important thing about this theorem is that it is actually about representation, not approximation. So this is the exact identity. It's not an approximation. It really is an exact identity. The internal functions that we have here, so the internal functions phi actually play the role of activations in some sense. But they are extremely complex. So they are certainly not explicitly given. They are not elementary. They are extremely complex. Also, it's remarkable then that this theorem is only for continuous functions. So there is no analog of this theorem for smooth functions. So at least nothing of this kind is known at present, and there are some counterexamples to certain cases. So this theorem actually is sometimes considered as the answer to the 13th Hilbert's problem about whether roots of a polynomial can be expressed in terms of functions of two variables. Though this is actually not exactly true, but nevertheless. Okay, I just put this picture here. So this is just from the slides of Dror Bar-Natan, who did apparently some simulation, just to convey the idea of the complexity of the proof. So the proof is a kind of clever and involved hierarchical replacement of d-dimensional connectedness by one-dimensional connectedness. So, so the pictures that you see here show the some precursors of the structures of the of this continuous function, which appear in this theorem. So they are pretty pretty complex actually. So I will just move on now. Immediately, well, soon after this theorem, there was some discussions whether this theorem is actually relevant or not for the neural network, for the usual field of neural network in the sense that we know them. And I put a couple of references here which explicitly contain this this claim that Kolmogorov's theorem is relevant or irrelevant. So the Kurkova's paper actually contains some construction which is based on the Kolmogorov theorem and which kind of explains it kind of in terms of more usual networks. But the complexity of this construction, of Kurkova's construction, is quite high. So I will not describe it here, but I want to state the result of Majorov and Pincus, which is much closer to the conventional neural networks. So what does it say? Essentially, it says that we can choose some special activation functions, one activation function, which has some nice properties, like it is analytic, it is sigmoidal, it is strictly increasing. And with this activation function, if we form a network with two hidden layers and a finite number of neurons, then we can achieve any arbitrary approximation of any given continuous function. So what is remarkable here, that this is a finite expression. It involves only finitely many neurons. The number of neurons remains fixed. But the complexity of the activation function is very big. So this is, it is presumably huge. It is not described analytically. It is not, it's not known if it is actually practically computable in any sense. But nevertheless, so this is this shows that we have kind of a different, quite different phase, if you will, where you have also have approximation which solves this approximation theory problem, but which is the logic of this construction is quite different. So the architecture here is very simple, but the structure of a single neuron is on the other hand very complex. Previously, we saw the different case when the architecture was large, but the we only need some kind of numbers with small precision for everything to work. Okay, here the architecture is in contrast very very simple. Now I want to return to the ReLU networks and describe a scenario in which we have much more conventional structures, which nevertheless have kind of non-standard approximation phase. So precisely, let's just take the usual deep fully connected architecture. So this is the ReLU network and the standard deep constant width architecture. Suppose let's just fix the network width. So let's just, for example, if we take it 2d plus 10, d is the input dimension, then it's okay. So if we fix the width, but we keep the depth, the number of weights variable. Okay, so the network can grow in the direction of depth, essentially. It turns out that in this case, we have a complexity accuracy relation, which is different from the classical one that I mentioned in the beginning. So we have this additional factor of 2, which is red, in the slides, and well, the difference does not seem to be very big, but it nevertheless it actually contradicts the this continuous theory that I explained earlier. Okay, so this approximation is obviously of a different type, so it's somehow qualitatively different. In particular, it cannot be obtained by continuous weight assignment. In contrast to what we saw earlier, so this we can only achieve this asymptotic if the weight assignment is discontinuous. The construction is based on the so-called bit extraction technique, which was introduced by Bartlett, Majorov, and Mayer. And the idea is that we can actually somehow, given some particular weight or a number more generally, we can extract the bits from it. So this can be done by a neural network, for example, the ReLU network or a threshold network. And this is a kind of bit shifting, actually. So you multiply the value by 2, you take the integer part, and so on, and repeat this. So this, as a result, given this number W, we kind of obtain, it is a real number, but as a result of this procedure, we obtain a sequence of integer numbers, B1, B2, and so on, which represent this binary decomposition of W. And this requires a deep network, actually. So this cannot be done with a shallow network. So they use this construction to prove that deep networks can achieve Vapnik-Chervaninkis dimension of order W squared. I will not discuss it in more detail. So now let's see what is the difference between the classical phase and this discontinuous phase. The classical phase, as I already just mentioned earlier, we can just think of it in this sense. So we can just consider just the case of one-dimensional function, univariate function, and Lipschitz function, for example, when we can just work with piecewise linear approximation. So we can think of it as in the following way. So we just divide our set, our interval, into subintervals, n subintervals, and then we just consider separately each of the subintervals. Each subinterval carries some simple approximation, and we combine all these approximation, all these approximations into one final prediction. So we actually, the classical phase requires the network to look into each of these subintervals, and the total complexity is of the order of n, where n is the number of these subintervals, and the accuracy is 1 over n. Again, in agreement with what we have discussed. Now, this discontinuous phase is quite different. So the logic is actually absolutely different. So we also divide this segment into subintervals, but after that, we make some further subdivision. We actually encode the approximation in each of these subintervals. Instead of using some simple, for example, linear formula, we define it by, for example, again, a piecewise linear function. Well, any function that is reasonably general and that can be encoded. So we need some kind of finite set of functions, and we can describe by, for example, by sequence of ones and zeros. And then we just encode it in the weight of the network. Then, when we want to compute the output of the network for a particular input x, we look at all these subintervals, we find the relevant subinterval, take the corresponding weight from where we have saved it, and reconstruct the whole approximation in this subinterval. And then we just use this reconstruction to compute this value of the approximation. So this, the total complexity of this approach is now of the order of n plus m, because we only have one application of this reconstruction. We have only one reconstruction subnetwork, which uses this bit extraction technique and reconstructs this partial approximation. And we have n because we still have to look into many intervals. So we have complexity n plus m, and the accuracy is actually 1 divided by n times m. And here we have gain. So here we get gain because this actually gives us this additional factor of 2, essentially. Okay, so the full, I just give a picture of the full phase diagram. So here, on the x-axis, we have the approximation rate, which can be achieved in principle. So this is the formula in the top of this slide, shows that what is p. P is the rate, basically, that we expect to achieve. In this picture, the x-axis is possible rates, and the y-axis is smoothness of the function, and d dimension is supposed to be fixed. So we see that on the left side we have this shallow, this is the continuous classical phase that I described earlier, and which is associated with shallow networks actually. So the corresponding p is r over d. And we also have a sector corresponding to discontinuous, to the discontinuous phase. So it is the border of the sector is the line r divided by d, and the right part of the border is 2r divided by d. So this is basically the whole sector is obtained by interpolating these two constructions, the classical phase and this discontinuous phase that I have just described. And with the Relu network, we cannot actually go further. So the faster rates are infeasible. So you cannot do better than 2r divided by d. Okay? So this table actually also, probably what I should mention, the something which is hidden in this, which was hidden in this discussion, but it is revealed if we look more closely at the information associated with the weights. So it turns out that the classical approximation, as we remember, requires the precision of a weight to be logarithmic in the approximation, accuracy. Whereas this new discontinuous phase actually is the power of the approximation accuracy, which means that we really need to have presumably very, very large precision of the number to be able to obtain improvement using this discontinuous construction. So in other words, if for some reason we have some resources of precision in the network and can think of the arithmetical operations as absolute, then this discontinuous phase really seems to be more efficient. Otherwise, just it doesn't, this does not actually work just because the actual information, the actual computation only transforms finite amounts of information, which was ignored in this discussion. Okay, and I will also briefly what happens. The initial question that appears here is what happens if we try some other activation functions, not as exotic as in the theorem of Pincus and Majorov that I have cited, where you have just some analytic unknown analytic function. Not as exotic, if they are still somehow explicit, elementary, but maybe more complex than just ReLU. But the answer is probably no. So if we are somehow within the conventional setting of neural networks, then probably we cannot really achieve further improvement, even with other activation functions. It is known in particular that in the case of the polynomial activations, basically we have the same rate, optimal rate. There are some other results that show that if the function, the activation function is Lipschitz and the weights are not growing too fast, then the maximum rate is also the same. And for standard sigmoid functions and some other functions actually, one can prove that slightly different bound, but again, so this is just some basic simple relation involving this complexity, the Sobolev complexity. Actually, this result is not at present, does not seem to be quite resolved, so it is not known if it is optimal or not in the case of more complex activation functions like this one, sigmoid one. But it appears that this is the best that can be achieved in any way. Now, but there is one subtlety. Actually, you can achieve theoretically much higher approximation rate if you use a periodic function, for example, the sine function. And if you make no restrictions again on the weights, if you allow them to be, if you kind of think of them as infinitely precise, and if you think of them as, if you allow them to be as large as they want. So in this case, theoretically, we can achieve approximation rate, which is exponential in the number of weights. So earlier, all the formulas were with power law relation, right? So the accuracy was a power law of the number of weights. But now it is actually exponential of the, the square root of the number of weights. So I will not go into details, but the main trick that one can use here is to use the, dichotomy-based bit addressing in the bit extraction technique. So the bit extraction technique that I have mentioned earlier, which is implemented using the ReLU function, is works one by one, bit by bit. So we extract the first bit, the second bit, and so on. But if we assume that we can somehow use the sign activation function, that we can actually do it more efficiently. We can do it using some kind of dichotomy. So take the middle of this sequence of bits, and then just go right, left, and use the standard division. And so that obviously we can locate the desired bit more efficiently in this way, which gives us substantial improvement because this bit extraction technique is the essential part of the of this discontinuous phase. Okay, so this is actually that's it. So I'm finished. Thank you for your attention. If you have any questions.